Okay, good morning everybody. My clock says 9 o'clock and as chairman it's my clock who rules. So I will welcome you all to our workshop. My name is Lars Storgård and I work in the Danish Ministry of the Environment. And in the next 3 hours we will tell you about the ministry's efforts, experience, recommendations when it comes to implementing and SDI when it comes to implementing Inspire and how that affects and influence on our engagement with the e-government issues. Building an SDI is going on several levels. I will start telling about the high level, our governance structure and how we work with out of strategies. We will go down in the more technical issues as well, and especially after the break we will see how we work with SDI issues in regard to the well-known data flow, data collection, data management and data distribution. The agenda looked like this. I will give the introduction to our ministry and how we are, how the governance setup is in regard to e-government, SDI, and Inspire. And after that, a short presentation of the Danish e-government strategy and where our ministry is involved. Especially, we are involved as a contributor of basic data. And the basic data program will be explained more in detail afterwards. And that includes the telling of how and where Inspire's framework is the foundation for the basic data. We will also give a more detailed presentation of one of the strategy's initiatives, the one which refers to quality and declaration of environmental data. And just before the break, a status of the Inspire implementation with some of our concerning issues and recommendations, challenges, perhaps you're dealing with the same kind. And as I said, the second session is built up by the well-known data flow, data collection, management and distribution. Firstly, we will see how new technology is being used in the Danish ministry's collection of data, mobile platforms and the use of drones. For monitoring and for monitoring the environment and nature. And secondly, we will see how we work for securing the data consolidation, a huge task for implementing SDI for the huge amount of data under the ministry's domain. A showcase of environmental data will be presented, mapping of noise according to the noise directive. And finally, we have the last link in the data flow, the distribution part. And one of the main distributors of the ministry's data is the Danish Natural Environment Portal. We will hear about the portal and how its role and experience as a Inspire service provider. And at the end, hopefully, there will be time and room for question and answer. Beside that, the presenters will give some time and space and room in each presentation. Here we have the presenters for the workshop. It's a wide range of experienced project managers, coordinators, experts in regard to SDI, e-government, standardization, and many, many, many other fields. Okay, the first presentation, an introduction to the ministry and our governance setup and how we work with strategies in regard to SDI and e-government and thereby Inspire. The Ministry of the Environment is one of 19 ministries in the Danish central government. It's in charge of administrative and research tasks in the area of environmental protection and planning. And more than 2,500 people works in the ministry, and we are organized in 3 agencies, and 1 independent appeal board is also linked to the ministry. Here we see the organization, our minister, Kirsten Brosbøl, and our permanent secretary, Henrik Studsgaard, who will be speaking at the opening plenary tomorrow morning. And we have the three agencies, Nature Agency, Geodata Agency, and an Environmental Protection Agency, and then the Environmental Board of Appeal, who deals with questions for issues and judgments regarding to the environment. And here we have the main businesses for the Geodata Agency in regard of INSPIRE implementation. The minister has assigned most of INSPIRE authority to the Geodata Agency. That means we represent Denmark in the INSPIRE committee and now in the two MIGs, the policy subgroup and the technical subgroup. We have the role of national contact point and the role of national reporter. We are responsible for the Infrastructure for Spatial Information Act. That's the Danish version which implements the INSPIRE directive. We lead the secretary for the Coordination Committee for Infrastructure for Spatial Information, where representatives for the Danish data providers are. We are also a basic data provider, primarily for Annex 1 dataset, the reference dataset. We are NCMA, so we have the cadastral map and all the topographic map. And finally, we maintain the Danish Discovery Service, our geoportal, Geodata Info, which I will show later on. And here we have the main businesses in the Nature Agency, and below that for the Environmental Protection Agency. And when we look at this list of tasks, it's obvious that it requires a huge range of data, and many of them are spatial, and thereby in scope of INSPIRE, as it is an environmental directive. So we are one of the largest data providers when it comes to INSPIRE data. And beside these businesses, we have a main task with the we have the obligation to report status for several environmental directives, and not only INSPIRE but all the thematics ones as well. Yeah, and as I said, the monitoring which we just delivered here medium May shows that the ministry is the main data provider when it comes to data set and when it comes to services. 65% of the Danish INSPIRE data are provided by these three agencies, and 67% of the services are provided by also by the ministry and the Danish Natural Environment Portal. You can go and visit our monitoring. It's available here. And this picture shows our landscape, our overall architecture. This is how it works. It looks something you probably know. Data hosted by their owners in the bottom. They are published through standardized interfaces, services, and are being used at the end by the users through applications. Our three agencies could be authority A, B, and C. It could be several others, but we are part of the infrastructure. I just want to highlight three common components. We have the portal, we have the digital map supply, and we have the discovery service, Geodata Info. The Natural Environment Portal will be presented last in the workshop. So just to tell about the other tools, we have this is a screen dump of the discovery service, the portal, Geodata Info, and it serves as a link in the infrastructure and supports these three workshops, a user search for data. A user evaluates if data is relevant given to a task, and data is available through information in the metadata. And this is where the Danish metadata are hosted and provided as services, and it is also here that the EU Inspire portal harvests metadata to the whole Europe. And the Digital Maps Prize, it's a component that the Geodata agencies are hosted, and it distributes data from our agency, including the Inspire compliant data sets. And the data are provided according to the implementing rules, a decision for download of a predefined data set with atom feeds. It's the atom feeds you can see here below. And beside this, web services are also provided as Inspire View Services, VMS. Okay, about now I have talked about data and metadata and services, portals and so on, but the implementation of SDI and management of such large amount of data, that's require strategy. All the components, data, metadata, and so on, they have to be available, yes, but their development and implementation has to rely on a strategy that shows the way to success. And when it comes to digitization in the ministry, we have such a strategy with a vision and a series of principles. The vision aims to on better service and transparency for citizens, businesses, and authorities. That's some high-level vision. But in the principle, we see that Inspire provides with its infrastructure model and its own principle. Data has to be maintained at the source, has to be reused, and so on. Easy access to data. The good principles. And the actually implementation of this strategy I just shown is carried out through a range of initiatives. Here's an example of such one, the one aiming building an SDI. We reviewed the work of conceptual models, data models and metadata, consolidate data quality in relation to dissemination, use and availability. And why is that? Environmental data is necessary for the administration of many specific working processes and for the policy making in the ministry. And in order to ensure more efficient processing, better use of environmental data and improve accountability, data must be easily accessible, reliable and updated. And with these words we can hear Inspire, especially the Inspire principles. And directives requirements for publishing metadata and effective services and interoperability, last but not least. Okay, so if you are given the task building an SDI, where to put the efforts? Well, some wise men says who have the experience in building e-government components, they say that organizational challenges are greater than the technical one. They are divided into 80% organization and 20% technical. I don't know if that's 100% correct, but the division is more or less right. And this is why we in the ministry have put many efforts in establishing the right governance setup, and why it has been changed over years and are still planned to be changed. We have to give the best possible structure for supporting the implementation of the SDI. So I will tell about the historical, current and future plan governance setup. The first one was established in 2007, Coordination Committee for e-government, with representatives for the agencies and the permanent secretary. And Their main delivery was the overall digitization strategy for the ministry, the one I showed before. And after that, that committee ran for 5 years to 2011. Then the time was mature to reorganize, so reorganize the governance so that it could be more operational and better to coordinate the actual implementation of the strategy. So we set out the committee on digitization and data, again with representatives from the agencies and permanent secretary. But the main challenge was that there was established two permanent secretary to the committee, secretary for the committee and secretary for data coordination. And one of the central tasks for this secretary is to screen all digitization and data projects and initiatives from the agencies before they can be approved in the committee. And this screening procedure is very central to secure reuse of system and data and components, and to secure that the data standards and reference architectures are being followed. And that includes the Inspire principle and data standards as well. And the concrete screening is carried out by representatives from the agencies, and to support the screening, common guidelines, best practices, checklists are provided. But along with the overall strategy in the ministry, we also have a second one, a more specific one when it comes to data and system. It's called Strategy for Management Environmental Data. And well, why another one? Well, we have this as is situation that no sufficient overview of which data are available, how and where they are being used, and that data exists in different versions and they are not well described. That's not a good and effective situation. So the strategy put out some initiatives, some projects, so we can go to this to be situation. And yeah, I will not go into a few of the details about this, because after the break we'll hear more about the strategy and its ongoing implementation. Beside this overall committee structure we also have a dedicated working group when it comes to Inspire, and it's here where the actual work is going on and we have hands-on with the projects. And the group works to ensure that the implementation of Inspire support the businesses' needs in the environment sector. And we are the connection between the EU level and the businesses when it comes to delivery information and best practices and standards. And we also clarify the ministry's position on draft materials, guidelines to the commission. And we have very good experience with having this group, because it's so dedicated to the Inspire implementation, and it's also familiar about the businesses in the agencies. Yeah, and I probably guess you can see who's member of the working group, and you will see me today, and you will also meet the other twos. Last but not least, the future governance setup. In the autumn, the governance setup will be changed once again, and this time it will not be another committee, but it will be a permanent unit or office placed in the Geodata Agency. And why this change? Well, the time is now mature to an even closer cooperation on digitization and data. And such closer and stronger cooperation is better secured in a dedicated unit rather in a committee. The major challenge for the unit is to remain the connection and contact to the business in the agencies. And yeah, that's true. The fact that an infrastructure cannot be a success if it's not is being used and fulfill the requirements in the businesses. But what are the goals? It's to be able to easier to integrate data, digitization, and IT, and easier to reuse system and data infrastructure. And in other words, again, we have the good Inspire principles as the main goal. Okay, this was the first introduction. You are welcome to ask or for clarification or others. Otherwise, I'll go to the next agenda point. And that's another introduction now to the e-government strategy, which is a common strategy for the whole public sector in Denmark. So now it's not only the Ministry of the Environment, but the whole public sector. But my focus will, of course, be of our ministry's involvement. We are involved in several initiatives, especially the one of basic data. And after my presentation, Fleming will give a more detailed one. Here you see the strategy. It has the headline, "The Digital Path to Future Welfare." And the central government are working from the strategy in order to accelerate the adoption of digital solutions in the public sector. And a very important aspect of the strategy is that it is being led by Ministry of Finance, and it has that aspect has a great importance for the impact of the strategy to the public sector where it's going to be implemented. That's where the money is. That's where the decision is. Denmark launched the first e-government strategy in 2001, and since then all levels of the public administration have been worked together closely to improving and extending their solution. Now we are in this one, the Digital Path to Future Welfare. We see what it includes: reuse of data, stronger collaboration. And the strategy has three main tracks, and it's in the third tracks that we find the focus areas involving the environment domain and the SDI. And here we see the first 8 out of in all 12 focus areas with more than 60 initiatives. And the Ministry of Environment is deeply involved. It is highlighted, focus area 8. Which aiming establishing a platform for efficient administration of the environment. And here we see focus area 8 in detail. It consists of projects, or initiatives, and the ministry is involved in all 4 of them. The Nature Agency in the first 3, and the Environmental Protection Agency in the last one. And in the highlighted text, you will see the purpose and the expected benefits from this focus area. Environmental data is available at the Natural Environment Portal, and metadata can be found in Geodata Info. And that sounds like good music in building an SDI, also according to Inspire. And here we have the last 4 focus areas, and the ministry is involved in initiatives 9.5, distribution of core data, or basic data as it's called now, and then the focus area 10, when it comes to shared basic data for all authorities. And here you see a description of Initiative 9.5 for the building of a data distributor. Basic data has to be easy to access and efficient to work with and very stable, and that's require a huge monster of a data provider, which you will also be hearing more about. And here you see the description of basic data, and he has highlighted what kind of data is in scope of basic data. And I know that the text is very small to you, and you will also see them highlighted next to me. But you will realize that this is also in scope of Inspire, especially Annex 1 themes. And yeah, we'll see the connection to Inspire later on. And yeah, with these requirements, that data has to be easy for the authority to use. They have to be well defined, well documented. It sounds like metadata, and the distribution of metadata, basic data, is also needed to be efficient and reliable. So it has to be very efficient and well-run services. And with that, I will give the chair to Flemming, who will give a more detailed presentation of the strategy and especially on basic data and how Inspire is involved there.
Yeah. Hello, good morning. It is a rather early morning. My name is Flemming Nissen from the Danish agency, Geodata Agency. We just got a new name for it. I was supposed to tell you about basic data. I am supposed to. Tell you about basic data and model rules that we call the methods to do the things. My disposition, you are welcome to interrupt me at any time. My disposition is on e-government strategies or strategy on the basic data program. The Danish part, or the part of the e-government strategy that deals with basic data, the Danish Geodata Agency's initiatives and projects on real estate properties, place names, and administrative units, and things in connection with some of the more public data that is not so geodata related. And I continue with the common data distributor, as Lars just mentioned, and I will end up with the model rules for basic data. Yes, I'm here to start a little pun. It's the rules for models, and here, model rules and models rules. Just to start the morning right. Let me start with the e-government strategy. In 2011, this strategy period started. It has been it has been in the future, but in the past, several strategies have been launched from 2003, I think, and this is the three or fourth of the strategies, and I know that we are working on the next one. Some of the initiatives are 10 areas of administration, which including public education, health, I call them social issues, of course, social administration, university, that springs up in gear, information about citizens, enterprises, the improvement of infrastructure, of course, the environmental situation, the basic data, and the improvement of legislation that is more ready for being implemented as supporting the administration. The basic data in the due data agencies deals with real estate properties, land parcels, I call it condominiums, flats that are owned by their owner, and a little curiosity, what we call buildings on foreign land, that would mean that buildings that is not owned by the same as the owned the land it lies upon. Then we are participating in the building and dwelling register, addresses. I'll come closer to that in a minute. And place names and administrative units, which are supporting some of the other public administration areas. And also we are involved in some of the projects on environmental and environmental data. It's for my sake, it is the water course administration. We are involved in, of course, in topographic data, and hereby the digital terrain models in various resolutions. And what we are not at this time involved in is the citizens' information and the enterprise information and the tax income. But we will be involved in a short while, I think. This is probably a figure that you will see as a number of times this week. This is the overall illustration of how the public data in or the basic data in Denmark is organized. We have a fairly old register for our citizens. We have registers for companies and enterprises, and we have registers, of course, for all the real estate properties, and some of the public administration deals with the administration of addresses because it serves a lot of times as a key for other registers. And of course, the due data positions many of these data as a supporting tool. When we are going to establish infrastructure based on basic data on and the supporting geodata, we look at the way that Inspire had modeled and put on the documentation of, in this case, UML models on various annex data sets that already had been both documented and published. If you see the yellow set of data, it is consisting of The green one is geodata, and the blue one is basic data. And the yellow one is a data set that uses Inspire as a basis, a foundation of how to model the rest of the public and basic data. Of course, there are some legacy data on the on both hands, but what we are going to deal with is to standardize the way we see basic data in all, in its all. For the way to moving forward, we have defined these model rules that I'll come back to, which will be common for all basic data. Then there's the data distributor, which will distribute all the basic data, and it will be governed by a setup of the decision structures that will be more than busy to finish this work. More than busy. Well, then let me jump to my next item. How we in practice deals with these basic data, and how we proceed and turn forward. For the real estate properties, the due data agency has become a host for some new object type features, that is the condominiums and buildings on foreign land. For a long period of time, we have had parcels in our registers, and those have been digitized for at least 20 years. Then, in order to integrate different kind of data which points to the same object or feature in the real estate area, we have been forced to defining a new common unique property identifier, and this shall be used for bringing all the different data sets together with local government data sets, which deals with the same thing, with taxation registers, which are not part of the basic data program yet, but they are supposed to be in a while. On the building and addresses projects, some new facilities have been introduced. We are going to, or the rather, the Ministry of Building and Land Districts have upgraded their administration, and they are closing nearer and nearer to a almost total administration of addresses and road names, naming, and the like. And because of that, addresses is a key information key, so to speak, it's a very important thing to have full and utterly control over. The modernizing of the register for buildings have included this new unique building identifier, as I talked about, and it's the same identifier as I mentioned on the land parcels, condominiums, and buildings on foreign land. And to the right, you see that there is a very integrating relationships between some of the different basic data sets. Addresses is one layer. Administrative units is part of the overall address, and the place name is a supporting information to an address, just like the administrative units. and administrative units could be at zip code here or some other kind of districts. On the other form of supporting data sets, we provide new place names, functionality, and administrative units that can be very easy and quick updated in a digital environment and digital administration environment. We are going to implement a very fast throughput from some customer has updated some point of addresses and some of the underlying information that constitute an address, and we are also, because of the place names, are we going to introduce some facility for voluntary geographic information, what is public and popular called crowdsourcing. This is not an issue that we have dealt with in detail, so we should see it as a test initiative at the moment. And then we have supplemented the already registered administrative units. We already have regions, municipalities, parishes, police districts, jurisdictions, constituencies, both for election and for new candidates to be put up as candidates. Then the zip codes that I named mentioned, and the new one is the supplementary city names used for address information support. And let me continue to the common data distributor. I hope that you still will interrupt me if you see the need for it. The data distributor is a facility that is not realized yet. We have made a specification a year ago, and it was put in public tender half a year ago, and just recently it was decided to run the contract, and the requirements to the data distributor was that it should have a better specification than the Inspire services, which should be available last year and this year and next year. First, some definitions: that normal load is what is loading 90% of the time. Discovery services request should return after 3 seconds. Raster image should return after 5 seconds. And the availability should be 99% of the time measured. More than 20 service requests per second. And this new data distributor, when it's realized, it should be better than these requirements, because the facility it should support is, of course, the storage of basic data to be distributed. It should be maintained by back office facilities and functionalities. It should be able to distribute events in a form, in a very standardized form. It should be heavily documented and preferably in UML, because we think that a lot of new users will take advantage of free basic data and will use them in their own enterprise and in own administration, if it's public administration. The data should be ruled by common model rules. And that's because it should be very easy to integrate different kind of features which are storage, which are stored in the data distributor. And it should have a very high capacity in terms of response time and availability. That's a short term for the figure at the right. We of course hope that it would be a private cloud implementation that could be reconfigured from day to day if some peak period should be necessary. And of course we expect a still increasing load, and we know that geodata is very popular and will still be loaded in very much sets of volumes, and the geodata is part of distributed by the data distributor. The logic, the very high level logic on the data distributor is what I've illustrated here. Underneath, below, is the basic data register, which is not one register, but at least 5, 6, or 10 registers. So I should, if it's very pedagogic, then it should have been put up in 5, 10 different kind of registers. And the push-pull functionality that maintains the data distributor is built on three layers. The basic infrastructure on the data distributor, which includes all the operating systems, the communications and networks facilities, the logging systems and security systems, and so on. And on the middle, there's what you can call some common functionality, which is above the operating system level, but underneath the platform level. So this is what you call all the ordinary functionality that is not aimed at some specific platform. Under the top, we have divided the platform in two parts, the register platform and the geodata platform, because geodata, as you probably know, includes some functionality and some aspect that a normal register has some difficulty to support. So that's why we have divided into two top platforms. And I hope and think that would be the right decision we took. And if I have not mentioned, it's clear enough that the purpose of the data distributor, then it's to ensure a common platform for other public data to be distributed from. And it should facilitate harmonizing and existing distribution solutions, and it should be ready to be maintained from the registers that feed into the common data distributor. And now to my final item, the model rules for basic data. This is an initiative that the basic data program has put up in order to harmonize and even standardize some of the ways we look at modeling the basic data. And the inspiration is from Inspire, of course. We have tried to be true against the principles of Inspire that Lars said was quite good. It's maybe not the the strongest word, but I agree. The models and the rules should be made in UML. They should be documented in UML and then should be exported and imported as files that can be read and written from other systems. So it should be a very a digital way to move models from one system to another. The models itself should be distribution models. That is to say, it is not a production model. It is not the model that support the administration directly in the owner's register. But this should be a distribution model. It should be ready for the users to eat, so to speak. And the models as well as in UML are conceptual. That will say that the physical structure of the models are not the concern of the modeling rules. And what you see is just some sketches on how an UML model can be visualized. And in this case, it is actually the administration units, which I should have be more go into deeper, but maybe some other presentation this week will do the same, do it all over. The model rules itself, there's of course the rules are consisting of statements of rules. Data models shall be modeled as UML classes. UML models shall be organized in packages, very technical terms, because some of these rules are designed to support the flow of models through systems that support and derive new way of the models to be implemented and realized. The model entities shall be reused, that is to say that no two domains should have the same concept, that they are modeled in different ways or naming them differently, but if they are the same, they should be called the same and they should be reused by some other administration. And if they are not the same, they should not be given the same name and then not reused, of course. And then the models should be documented and modeled in all its entities, because the relationships and associations, roles and multiplicities should also be part of the model, although it's in many often cases it is optional if you are putting identifiers on all the entities. The model rules shall be based on ISO 19103 and 7, the harmonized model, at least the one that can be. There have some geodata aspects inside. The UML stereotypes shall be used also for the functionality of moving a model between systems. Of course, the data model shall be documented, but that's it's a side effect on putting on modeling it in UML. References to classifications, business models, and organization models should be used. That refers to that we use the same environments, the same way of seeing the world, so we use the same terms and concepts for describing. The way we in the Geodata agency actually is going to produce models is by a suite of tools. We use the enterprise architects to UML model all the distribution models. We use an open source tool called Shape Change, which is also known from the Inspire world. And then we have started making up some scripts for supporting the further deriving and usability of the models in order to implement and realize the models in distribution systems and databases that support a data model, even if it's a physical adaption. And what is not surprising is that all model entities, all features, all object instances should be modeled with persistent, unique identifiers. This is, I cannot stress too much, but you of course all aware of that. All models shall be modeled with a field called status, which is a mandatory field for all the data sets, and as well the model shall be modeled with what we call bitemporal information on when and when they were born and when they died, and both the object and the reality, so to speak, because valid from and valid to is time stamps that deals with that information. And at last the responsible actor is put into this event part of the model, and it should be rather easy to make a historical selections inside the data distributor to find the traceable instance that gave basic for an administrative decision. And I just mentioned that. And let's conclude my presentation on basic data and modeling issues. Thank you. And do we take questions now or later?
Yeah, it's time for questions. Thank you very much for your very interesting presentation. When you talked about the model rules, the second set of rules, you talk about the reuse of the entities, UML entities, model entities. How do you ensure that these entities shall be reused? How do you advertise to other people that you have an entity that is interesting for them?
Well, in my mind, the situation where we have a common registry, where we gather all the models and their packages, should be at least a necessary requirement, maybe not sufficient requirement. But I hope we have not reached that moment yet, but I hope that we will be able to govern this kind of harmonizing, so it should be at least possible to look up in that registry to find candidates for some of the models that you, or part of models that you are going to make your own if you are not use some other part of the overall central registry models.
Norway or Sweden that have interesting models that you want to use?
I think it's a good question. I think it's a good question, which I have not an immediate answer to. But the very fast way of thinking is to establish an even more central registry for models that even Norway and Sweden can look into. And maybe other countries as well.
So you're almost suggesting that at European level there be a federated registry so that people are able to search also entities?
Well, I haven't thought it through yet, but it will be very nærliggende. Heidi? I think that I have a Danish one, but well, let's have to look into it to see if we have some material you can use.
Yeah, I will be interested.
Any more questions?
Jeg har stået med den her.
Nå.
Hvad siger du?
Derfor jeg ikke se noget.
Lars, vi skal have en. Der er det på den ene, men ikke på den.
Thank you. First of all, thank you for having me in and present to you the initiative 8.3 under the e-government strategy. It's called Quality and Declaration of Environmental Data. And my name is Thomas Hjort. I'm from the Nature Agency. And one of the things I do is I'm working as a project manager on this project. So, first of all, let me just scope what data we are addressing in this initiative at first. That is the observation of environmental parameters from the surface waters in Denmark. That is the sea, the lakes, and the watercourses. I should point out that the project does not include data from point sources, from groundwater, or from nature, and so on. And I should also stress that the geometry of watercourses and lakes, the topology, are not covered by this project. That is covered by the basic data program under the strategy. Fleming just showed one slide, if you were quite attentive. The data sets we're addressing, they form the basis of our national environmental management. They are, of course, essential in the implementation of all international agreements and directive. One is the Water Framework Directive, as the relation to INSPIRE, well, they relate these data set directly to the theme of environmental monitoring facilities under the Annex 3. And indirectly, they also relate to some of the other themes, because, for instance, species distribution, you could take the raw data, the raw observations from lakes, and you can create an species distribution theme. So as such, they are also indirectly related. These are the data sets, along with some of my colleagues out in the field. I will not take them all from an end, but you can see there are quite a lot of things that are observed in the nature. The oldest data, they stem back from the 1908, if I remember correctly. But the main part of the data, they come from, they are from 1988 and onwards, when the first aquatic environment action plan was established in Denmark. If you have to understand where we are today with these data, we will have to look just a little bit on the history of the management of these data sets. This was the situation prior to 2007, when we had a big structural reform in Denmark. At that time, we had 14 regional counties who were responsible for these data sets. And they had a lot of data systems where they were handling these data sets in. There were 35 or more data systems. And once a year, the data were delivered to the ministry or to the NERI, National Environmental Research Institute, who are working for the ministry and at that time was actually a part of the ministry. From the ministry in NERI, the international reporting was done, and the national reporting, and so on. There were at that time 271 municipalities in Denmark who had only limited access to data and were really not in strong demand of data. Also, the same applies to the public and other authorities. They may need data, but there were only a limited access to data. Then in 2007, we had the structural reform I told you. At that time, the environmental tasks that were done by the regional counties were transferred to in part to the municipalities and in part to the ministry. And at the same time, we established the Danish Natural Environmental Portal, which you will be presented to after the break at some point. But that was a data cooperation between the authorities, the regions, the municipalities and the state, the Ministry of Environment. And the data from the 35 systems were consolidated into now 6 systems. So that was quite a step. And from being those were systems used by some of the counties. So these systems were going from being used by one county to being used by 98 municipalities and the ministry. At the same time, or around the same time, the ministry and NERI started a project on data equality and data declaration, because that was needed in order to manage the data collected under the environmental monitoring program we have in Denmark. And we set up, that was a temporary solution that was set up, that was thought to be a temporary solution, with the daily data transfers from the systems on your left to a new database where the quality assurance was done. That was, as I said, on a part of data, that was the data collected in the monitoring program. Some of these data were then are now transferred back to the Danish Natural Environmental Portal and to be publicly available through their solution DAI, it's called. And the transfer around that database on your right is in order to have the quality declaration on the data that we are publicly making available. So these are some of the systems, and they're all bright colors and a lot of buttons and a lot of numbers and things, but we do have challenges. It's not all about color and buttons. So, first of all, they are from the early 1990s, so they are obsolete, to say the least, technologically. And they are also often maintained by only one developer. That means that's a quite risky situation, that if he's run over by a bus, we have some problems. We are at Inspire. I can tell you there are absolutely no maps in any of those systems that are used by the authorities. So that means mainly a user has to remember what is the number of the stations that I'm working with. And that's of course not totally ideal. Of course you have the coordinates of stations, and you can plot them on a map and find what stations you are, but that's not ideal. Data redundancy between the system, the same monitoring or monitoring stations could be defined in several of the systems and in the same system also several times. That's just how it is and how it goes. There are no quality control of data. When they are entered, that would be ideal. You're entering data and you are immediately fed by with some quality warnings. You don't have that, because it was not until next day that they are available in the system at your right, you saw. So that not ideal. Also, we see that the business requirements are changing. First of all, data are, to a greater extent, being used across the authorities in Denmark. And that means we have to declare something on the data. We have to declare their quality. We also observe they are collected for an increasing number of different purposes, by an increasing number of producers. There's an increasing demand for easy accessibility to data by authorities, public and the private sector. That means self-service access to the data, because if asked to, we of course we take data out of the system and send them to whoever wants the data. So as such, they are open, but it's not easy to get the data. Anyhow, we see an increasing demand for system-to-system integration. If we want to have mobile access and mobile registration out in the field, We are not able to because these are silo systems at the moment. So not until we have some means of creating that system-to-system integration are we able to move forward in this part of the data with, for instance, mobile solutions. So what do we do? There are two possible options: continue patching, so on, or we could establish a new infrastructure if we chose the latter of those two. So how does that look? What are we planning to build? We haven't built it yet, but we are planning to create something like this. And what the initiative 8.3 is about will be is the red deal of the red part. We create, first of all, a new database. Instead of the 6 database, we now create 1 database, 1 data model, and we create a service layer so that you are able to integrate system to system. We create a component for calculations that are shared across boundaries of authorities. We have some sort of distribution interface, and we have some basic applications up on the left corner to get a means of getting data in and out of the system and doing the quality declaration and assurance, but not more than that as such, because third-party application has to cover the specific needs of the individual authorities. So when we are dealing with, for instance, in the ministry, with the Water Framework Directive, we could need some solutions to handle these data, and that we will have to make ourselves. Because if they are not something that are in demands by the municipalities or the regions. So the last component was the one on the data quality. And just to put some words on that one, it's obviously that in order to share the data, you have to have a common understanding of what data you are sharing and what the quality are. That is sort of metadata, but not on a scale of a data set, but quality and declaration of the individual observations in the data set. The quality component will be based on the principle used by NURI and developed by NURI and the ministry in collaboration. That was the right part of the existing infrastructure. Yes. The first, the principle are based on a ladder scale, where you have some levels of quality control. And the first levels should be automated as far as possible. And no data should be allowed to enter the system without those, without this level of quality control. They are, of course, in part defined by the database and the rules in the database, but there could be other rules enforced at this level. Then we have a further quality control levels that should be based on procedures. And that could depend on the requirements of those data, if they are used to that purpose or that purpose. It could be different what the quality control should be based on. That is just the latter, where you have data model rules in the bottom, and then automated quality control, and then some manual quality control at the top. These just examples. That was the first level, this ultimate control, right, where you are serving a temperature of 21 kilos. That probably not good, and a sample date in the future, and missing methods by which the data were collected, for instance. Second level warnings, they are warnings. That means you can discard them, or you can accept them, or you can do something about the data. For instance, if you observe a lower concentration than expected from statistical analysis, you get a warning, and you can choose to accept the value, or you can decline it. Or if there are some species that has never been observed at some point, you can have a warning about that. I will just skip this, but that is how it's set up in the system we are using with NIRI at the time of now. What we do is that you can say that's on the top. You expand the data search area. We have to set up some ranges for normal concentration level, for instance. That means the temperature can only be from 20 to 30 degrees at a fjord in a certain month. So to set up those statistics, we expand the data search area, both spatial and temporal, in order to set up some statistics or have enough data to set them up. Just to summarize, time's going. Under the A3, a new database containing data from the surface water will be established. We will put emphasis on the improvement of the quality control support and the declaration of data, as this is necessary when sharing data between authorities. The access to data will be improved for the public and for other authorities and for ourselves. We create some basic applications for data entry, and some common calculation components will be developed. Specific needs by individual authorities has to be served by third-party applications. That's just to sum it up. I'm here at the entire conference, and you're welcome to contact me, because I'm sure that your countries have been in the same situation, or maybe you have some good ideas, maybe you have some perfect data models. At least they're the same data we are collecting in the field. So you are feel free to contact me at any time. Thank you.
Other questions to Thomas? This seems a quite separate system of data collection. Do you have in Denmark a federal system or a central system of government? So do you have to coordinate regions, or are you in the environment ministry responsible for this data yourself?
We are responsible for some of the data, but we have this the Danish environmental portal, where we are collaborating with the municipalities about working on the same data set. Same data, the data should only be stored one place, you would say. So we have that. And there are data we are only ourselves responsible for. But we are trying to establish the cooperation and working on the same data. Not in the way that they have to deliver data and have their own, in the municipalities, their own databases, and then delivering. No, it should be one database where they are working on the data by either third-party application or these basic applications we are sharing between authorities.
Sorry, do you have different regional legislation? So do you have different types of data, or are they collected on the basis of the same laws?
We have different laws and different requirements for the data. Yes, we are trying to, we are hoping that they could be collected on the basis of the same technical guidelines, because that is not the case for all data right now. But all data collected as part of the monitoring program, the national monitoring program, they are based on common descriptions or clear descriptions of how the data should be collected and so on. So, but still, when you are assessing, for instance, the impact of the environment, it's not always based on the methods in the environmental monitoring program. So we are working on that.
You mentioned that you are planning also to improve the or facilitate the data access. Did you already look at the activities going on at the moment for the SOS and send automation?
I was there yesterday. So, and of course, yes, that would be obvious. We have a data view, and some of the data are sensor data. So that would be obviously to create some. It seemed so easy yesterday, at least. So why not? Yeah. Yeah, we could talk about that.
Source.
Yeah.
Does that mean that you are moving all your data to some kind of a cloud infrastructure or one of these servers somewhere?
Yes. Actually, we are at the moment working on the same data. If I'm just going back here. That was a lot. We are working on the same data set right now under the Danish Natural Environments Portal. And actually, those systems, those old systems, are hosted in the cloud, as far as I know. So we are there right now. We are just under the Natural Environments Portal then collecting or establishing, putting them into one database instead. So we are working on the same data sets now. No more? Ah.
In your first slide, you said this project or this sub-project does not include the observation data, so the actual monitoring data. How do you bring then this monitoring data into the system?
I have said something wrong then, because the observations are. There are observations from of environmental parameters. That is temperature and oxygen concentrations and so on.
Perhaps it was the point sources.
Yeah, the point sources. They are actually, there's another database established. And the data model, we are looking into the data model and reusing that data model maybe in the new solutions but that's more from historical reasons, I think, that we are not including point sources in this system.
Okay. According to the agenda, we have some recommendations and experience according to the INSPIRE implementation, but the time says almost COVID.